What's going on, guys? Medivert here with Lethal Camaro, and today I'm going to be taking a drive, a little bit different format here, but it's been a while, and I want to do something different. So, going to take a drive, and today's topic is why I'm going with a Pro Charger over a Root Style or a Supercharger that bolts on where your intake manifold goes. Let's go ahead and start the car up and get this drive going. Guys, we are driving, and as I mentioned earlier, I want to talk about why I decided to go with a Pro Charger over a normal Supercharger. Now, a lot of people get them confused. They'll call one a Supercharger and the other not. I don't know why. Or Pro Charger is just the name. So there's a couple companies who make a Pro Charger style system. There's Vortec, there's the company Pro Charger who makes the Pro Charger, and then there's all the other types of Superchargers out there, which again, they're both Superchargers. It's just how they work or how they hook up to the motor that's different. Now, a Pro Charger sits off in front of the block of the motor. It hooks up into your normal system and blows air into your intake manifold in creating more air, which in turn creates more power, and yay, you're happy. It does hook up to an intercooler, so the air being forced into the vehicle is cooler in general, but overall, the way it functions is slightly different than your typical Root style setup. And you'll say Root style, what the heck does that mean? A supercharger like a Whipple or an Edelbrock, those would be considered a Root style supercharger. They sit on top of your heads, replace your intake manifold directly, and suck and force air into your vehicle, creating more power. Now, the similarities between the two is they are both ran off your belt train on the front of the motor. So the supercharger's system and the Pro Charger system, the fan or blower or whatever you want to call it, is hooked up and it's belt driven and it takes power to create power. Now, that's slightly different from a turbocharger, as a turbocharger's ran from your exhaust gases. And so therefore it's not hooked up to any power or sucking power from the motor. It's using spent gases and pressure to spin up a turbine to then create that power. Same principle at that point, forcing air through the system. Now, how does this all work in regards to a Whipple style versus a Pro Charger style supercharger? Now, the big difference is where that power is coming in. Now, one, you're always gonna have a little bit of ramp up on your power. Now, it's not as long as turbo lag, which you may have heard, which turbos will typically suffer from. The bigger the turbo you have, the longer it takes to spin up. Therefore, when you hit the power, you have to wait for that to kind of spin up and get the power. Then the turbo kicks in and you're like, holy crap, power. A supercharger, because it's belt driven, it is completely managed by the RPM range and how you're managing it. But depending on how the air is being delivered, now in the instance of a Whipple, all of the force of the air is happening beyond the throttle body, whereas a Pro Charger, all that air is hitting the throttle body, so it's really being driven by you opening it up and driving. So as soon as you hit that pedal, your throttle body opens and all that air is forcing through. Now, in that instance, a Pro Charger is creating a ton of back pressure in your system. So usually they will have a wastegate or a blow-off valve of sorts, and people will probably stab me for saying wastegate, but whatever. We'll stick with blow-off valve. And that alleviates the pressure as it builds up as you don't need it. And you will hear it in a Pro Charger system, and some people will think that your car is turbocharged because of it. Now, how is that different, or what's the difference in regards to having that Whipple style, Root style, Whipple, Edelbrock, or the Pro Charger, which like Pro Charger or Vortec? It's really where you're getting your power and when it's kicking in. Now, a Root style supercharger, you're gonna get your power in the lower RPM range. It's going to come in, you're going to get your power, you're gassing it. Think of like quarter mile or stuff like that. You're just gassing your motor and you're getting all your power, your go, go, going, and you're going to hit that RPM range that your supercharger's at, and you're just not going to feel a lot more pull in the upper RPM range. But you're going to feel a crap ton of pull in the lower RPM range. Now, jump ahead to the Pro Charger, and your power in general is coming in the mid-range RPM range. So around 3,000, 3,500, again, all depending on the build, all depending how it's tuned, you're going to feel a lot of that power coming in mid-range. So it's really good for guys who are at normal racetrack driving, stuff like that. And when I say normal racetrack driving, let's just go like Button Willow, Chuckawalla Raceway, stuff like that. You're usually driving your car second, third gear, maybe fourth, and you're sitting in your power, you know, your power, why am I forget words? Words, where are words? You're sitting in your power band, and you're just sitting in that pure power the whole time, and you're up and down shifting depending on what corners you're going into or coming out of, or if you're flying across a straightaway. And the big thing there is your power. You can always sit in that band, and you can always sit in that band with a Whipple style or Root style setup, but it just depends on how you drive and what characteristics you want. Overall, the power gain from either or, it depends on the system and the power that they're advertising. I've seen most people with Pro Charger builds getting more power to the wheels than I am seeing people with Root style setups. Bigger reason is you can go with bigger and bigger, basically boost, or like Pro Charger has multiple series, like the P1, the D1, I think it's like the FX1 or something like that. But it's basically bigger and bigger systems that can force more and more air, which in turn yields more power. So the Root style, you're limited in height and, you know, really just height. So you'll see most guys who are running bigger Whipple chargers and stuff like that, they'll have massive hoods or big blower hoods, kind of like you see on the Copo and stuff like that. So you can get more air out of a Whipple, but it requires you to do more modifications, in my opinion. I'm sure some people can get away without modifying it. I just haven't seen it yet. You'll also notice a lot of the Whipple systems are the ones where you'll start seeing like holes having to be added into your stock hood if you're not willing to upgrade your hood. And that's, again, because they're going with a taller stack that gets more airflow in there, which in turn yields to more power. So in my instance, this is my daily driver, so I wanted something that wasn't going to melt my tires every time I touch the gas. And I wanted something that if I do go to a racetrack like Button Willow or Chuckawalla, I can drive it. Now, a lot of people have been calling my car a garage queen. Yeah, it really has been. I've been focusing on my build, focusing on getting all the parts, and just about every time I've wanted to go to the track, it's been pouring rain. And shockingly, California, that's not heard of. So it's been an awkward last couple months, but spring's here. It's actually a really nice, it's 90 degrees outside right now. I just got back from my journey from Sweden, so which was super ice cold out there. It was snowing, but you know, I'm looking forward to finally being able to get out to the track and actually race the car per se. So I have no idea how she handles on a track with the tires. I have no idea how she handles on the track with the new sway bars. And I have no idea how she's going to handle on the track once I put the Pro Charger on, which is going on, you know, on March 20th. And I didn't have my AC on. I'm going to turn some air on because it is actually getting warm out. So that being said, you know, there's a lot of things I want to continue to do to my car. Again, the Pro Charger being the first thing. Now, there's a lot of things that are going to have to happen after that, but for my car to run as it will, we'll probably have to limit it on the power that it's generating. It's going to take quite a bit of fine tuning just because of the fuel system on the car. The stock fuel system can only handle so much power or keep up with generating so much power just because of the fuel pump and the injectors that come stock. So I have to start looking at those options to be able to generate more power to get my build to hopefully where I'm at. But I think after the Pro Charger's on, I'll be sitting probably 600-ish to the wheels, plus or minus. It just all depends on how that tune pans out. Now, I hope that kind of answered why I'm going with a Pro Charger over a Root style supercharger. I mean, a lot of people go for a lot of different ways for different reasons. For me, this is my daily driver. That was the primary reason why I wanted the Pro Charger setup, because I can lightly hit on my gas and drive off the line around town and not have to worry about melting my tires and still have perfect city drivability or even highway drivability if I want. But when I do want the power, I could just wide open throttle her and that power is going to kick in where I want it, and she's going to pull and pull and pull all the way through the RPM range. So I'm very much looking forward to seeing how the Pro Charger transforms this build and this car. I did build the cam to compensate for force induction, so my cam power gains will be seen once the Pro Charger is on. But do know, I already know I'm going to hit a fat wall right up front in regards to how much power we can generate because of the fuel system. So looking at all sorts of things across the board on the build, so it's just a slow and steady thing. I don't have $1 million. I do have to set aside money every month or every paycheck, or luckily there is some YouTube funds coming in and stuff from these videos. So, but you know, that's one of the big reasons why the time delay and the constant wait in between things. You know, not everyone's made of a ton of money, and I don't really feel like going into crazy debt on my car for car parts. So I'm waiting until I could pay cash for it. So I highly encourage you all to do so. But like I have mentioned this before, I put my R888s on credit card. I just paid that off, so really happy to do that well before they wore through. But yeah, so either or, let me know what you guys think. Are you guys looking at getting a supercharger build? And if so, are you looking at a Route style? Are you looking at a Pro Charge setup? Either or, I'd love to know in the comments. You know, outside of that, what are you guys doing to your build? What kind of things are you taking into consideration before pulling the trigger? Or are you guys being heavily influenced by just seeing power gains and be like, hey, I want that too, that's what I want, not really even considering how the power band, where it kicks in, what kind of upgrades you also have to consider? Because not only do I have to really think about the fuel system, I'm going to have to start thinking about potentially axles for this car. And one thing I do want to throw out there, most people who have had problems with the axles on the 6th-gen Camaro are manuals. And if you guys don't understand how manuals work, you will understand that it's all on the driver on how they're shifting. And also, there's a lot more wheel hop with a manual setup than there is, actually, I haven't felt any sort of wheel hop, so with the A8. Now, that's also something you should consider in if you haven't purchased your car yet. If you're looking to buy the car and build it out and you haven't done anything yet, you know, look into the things that you have to consider with a manual 6 and an A8 auto, or even if you're looking at a ZL1 with the A10. The manual 6, just the way that a manual works, you're putting a lot more torque into the back of that car faster than you are an automatic, and you can snap axles. Say, and then you have to consider tire hop and all that kind of stuff. That just adds to the equation of potentially breaking things. So not saying that I'm fully in the clear, but I will tell you what, all the cars that I've seen with A8 autos have not had any of the issues I've been seeing with the manual sixes. So just something to consider and something to think about. I decided long ago I was gonna go an A8. I have a ton of videos talking about why I chose an A8 or the different reasons why. A lot of it had to do with traffic at the time with my long commute. But now with me not driving nearly as much to work, I think my next car will be a manual, and I don't know if I'm gonna go this far on the build for whatever my next car will be, but either or, thanks for watching the video, guys. Again, let me know in the comments below what you guys are thinking about with your builds or what you've done and what you have experienced. I'd also love to know, manual 6 and automatic guys, if you do have a supercharger, Pro Charger setup on your vehicle, what other things have you done to your car? I know there's quite a few people out there now that have pretty advanced builds. I wouldn't say mine's advanced yet. I mean, putting a Pro Charger is a pretty easy bolt-on that can pull right off. But you know, doing a cam and exhaust, I mean, I basically have bolt-ons with a cam, which is like a baby kickoff of a build. So I think once putting the Pro Charger on there, working on the fuel rails, I mean, I'll probably end up rebuilding the bottom end and probably doing new heads, but We'll see. We'll see what happens. That would be constitutional, or that would constitute as a full build. So either or, we'll see what happens. Again, it's all money. At this point, I'm having to save pennies to afford the other things that I want. I have blown all my savings that I had built up to buy this car and do the mods to it. So I'm just at that point in my build where things are going to take longer and longer to achieve. So hang in there with me. Again, we do have the Pro Charger going on. I do have most of the funds saved for the fuel system, but as far as like getting new axles and stuff like that, I don't have that saved yet, so those are coming down the line. But thanks for watching the video, and as always, if you enjoyed the content, hit that subscribe button, support the channel. Likes, comments, shares are appreciated, and until next time, I hope to see you on the road.